This is the American Film Institute Life Achievement Award, the highest honor for a career in film, whose distinguished recipients have created some of the finest moments in the history of motion pictures. Annual American Film Institute Life Achievement Award. A salute to Steven Spielberg. Tonight, the American Film Institute invites you to join our host, Tom Hanks, as leaders in the motion picture and television community gather at the Beverly Hilton in Los Angeles to pay tribute to a director whose work includes some of America's most memorable films. Ladies and gentlemen, Steven Spielberg. Ladies and gentlemen, Tom Hanks.
In 1969, I was walking to school with my friends, and all we were talking about was whether we saw a night gallery the night before. It was this this new TV show that had spooked us all silly, especially that one amazing episode about that lady that didn't have any eyes, and so she bought a pair of eyes that would work, but they'd only work for just one night. But then the power went out, and she was plunged right back into darkness just as those new eyes started to work, and wasn't that a cool episode? Well, later we found out that lady was named Joan Crawford. And although I didn't know it, that night was also the first time I encountered a man who would become my neighbor, my friend, my colleague, and the 23rd recipient of the American Film Institute Life Achievement Award. Like all of us, I met Steven Spielberg the same way a billion or so other people have, sitting in rapt attention in front of a screen, enthralled by the fear, the fun, and the honest innocence he puts on film. And the next time I saw Steven was when I went to see this Jaws movie. And it was the first movie I ever had to wait in line to see on a very, very confusing evening because it was before they had worked out that separate line for ticket holders only. So it was all, wait, I'm in line, you're in line to see the movie, I have to go to that line, I gotta go to that line, buy a ticket, then come back and stand in this line. I gotta get that at the end of that line, buy a ticket, get at the end of this line. This doesn't make any sense. See, that sign for ticket holders only, it was invented all because of Steven Spielberg. And you can think of it as just another one of his many contributions to the film industry. Well, now I don't have to stand in line to see Steven. I can just look over our backyard fence and there he is, mowing the lawn. Every Saturday, 3:30. Fertilizer, edging. And I know that the man is as amazing as his movies. He is unstoppable. He has this unbelievable, unshakable confidence in an idea. And for every film he makes, there are 1,000 more that play inside his head. I think his cranium houses the world's largest multiplex cinema and is open all hours every day. After Steve and I became friends, I found out that we were both junior high school AV boys. Audiovisual. You know, we're the guys who carried the Bell and Howell movie projectors from classroom to classroom. And we knew how to thread up the Encyclopedia Britannica films so they wouldn't sound like this. Now tonight he joins the company of those whose work in film has stood the test of time. For us, for our children, and generations beyond, he is and will be the best proof that movies really are the magic lantern. And Steven himself will be up on this stage, standing in the place of Ford, of Capra, of Lean, and of Hitchcock. He'll be surrounded by sharks. And dinosaurs. There'll be an ancient ark, and there will be shades of epic heroism. This is the world of Steven Spielberg, and the man who's created it is, I assure you, positively extraordinary, and maybe even extraterrestrial. From his very first moment, Steven Spielberg had his eye on the camera. As a boy, he was blessed with a sense of wonder and a vivid imagination. His family moved from Cincinnati to Scottsdale, Arizona. A suburban life complete with three sisters, a backyard, and home movies. A dreamy kind of kid, he took one look at the camera and began to wonder about its possibilities. "Give Daddy back the camera, Steven." "Uh-uh," he said. "I want to try something." What he tried was turning his house and family into a movie studio. His sisters were movie queens. Their dolls were miniature monsters. And dollhouses were castles of fire. When his vision outgrew his own backyard, he persuaded the local airport to close down an entire runway. Thank you.
By 15, he was creating full-scale productions, recruiting his whole class for a wartime drama. But Stephen's imagination was filled with other kinds of stories about ordinary people who encounter the extraordinary. It was called Firelight. Theater, a $100 net profit, and Stephen had his first smash hit. The summer his family moved to Los Angeles, naturally, he took a tour of a Hollywood studio. The next day, he was back, only this time, 17-year-old Stephen dressed in a suit and carried a briefcase. He waved confidently at the guard, found an empty office, and put his name on the door. Every day, for 3 months, he lived on movie sets. But to get himself noticed, he needed a 35mm film of his own. Shot without dialogue, because he couldn't afford it. Amblin was a playful film about two kids who hitchhike across the desert. 22 minutes of inventiveness won him a contract with Universal's television department. At age 20, he was directing Joan Crawford. A year later, he cast a truck as the villain in a movie of the week and drove a conventional chase out of cliche and into breathless cinematic drama. Duel. Now a classic, was just the beginning.
Ladies and gentlemen, Richard Dreyfuss.
When Stephen first asked me to do Jaws, he sat me down and he described the way that he would shoot this film. And it was a breathtaking experience. And when he was finished, he said, "Do you want to shoot this movie with me?" And I said, "No." And he said, "Why not?" And I said, "Because this is going to be a rough one. I'd rather watch this movie than shoot it." He forgave me for that insanity, and he hired me, and we started to shoot the movie on Martha's Vineyard without a final script, without a final cast, and without a final shark. So while we were shooting, the editor, Verna Fields, would take out a list of the shots that she thought that she needed, and then Stephen would sit there, and with our help, he would write the next day's script. It was really one of the most extraordinary collaborative experiences I have ever had. As a person, he is unbelievably optimistic. And as an artist, he has insisted on the values of innocence and love and human courage. And he has insisted that those values can prevail. Now, Stephen is getting this Life Achievement Award when he is 47 years old. That only means to me that he's going to get two. And someday, I am absolutely sure, I will be sitting on the porch of the old actor's home. My teeth will be in a glass somewhere over there, and I will attempt to get up and go to Stephen's next Life Achievement Award.
They took him away.
What's the matter with you?
Shut up! You get out of there! You go get him! You lied to me! Go get him!
I can't
right
do
out
that.
Here! Me! You promised!
I can't!
Out there and get him!
I'm gonna kill him!
Get him!
No!
Yes!
No!
But it won't be clean.
Take that goddamn wood out! Go ahead, fly!
Hooper, hurry it up now, tie it on. Hurry it up, he's coming straight for us. Don't screw it up now.
Don't wait for me.
Somebody's taking all this down.
What are we saying to each other?
Seems they're trying to teach us a basic tonal vocabulary.
First day of school, fella. Takes everything from the lady.
Buy it.
All of her pattern notes and her one.
We have a translation airlock on their audio signal. We're taking over this conversation now.
Ladies and gentlemen, Goldie Hawn.
Sugarland Express was Stephen's first feature film, and for both of us, it was the beginning of our careers. What I remember most is Stephen's tremendous empathy for who our characters were. He had brain work going a zillion miles an hour. But through it all, he had such a hand on the heartbeat of the people. I sensed that when we were shooting Sugarland that Stephen was extraordinary. He was almost a force of nature. But I didn't have any idea of the empire that he would become. We were just kids expressing ourselves and doing our best. Stephen still is. And I can't think of anyone who does it better. A number of your friends and colleagues have come here to salute you tonight. He starred in Duel, Dennis Weaver.
Duel was Stephen's first full-length film. He was only 23, and the studio called me up and asked me if I would okay a young director that they had under contract. I think I'm the only actor that ever okayed Steven Spielberg. You know, a lot of times interviewers will ask me, Dennis, did you know at the time that you were making Duel that Stephen was going to have the kind of impact on the industry that he has had? Well, you know, Stephen, I knew that you were talented. I knew that you were always going to have a job. But no, there is absolutely no way that I knew that you were going to be a legend by the time you were 30. No way. For heaven's sakes, if I'd have known that, Stephen, I wouldn't have just okayed you. I would have adopted you.
To Stephen, the story is everything. And the tales of Spielberg unfold so naturally that they make the absolutely improbable seem absolutely inevitable. Now, in the end, there is the image, the flash of visual brilliance, the wonder of an audience transported to other places and other times, other worlds. But in the beginning, with Stephen, there is the word and the story.
be here. Has been extinct since the Cretaceous period. I mean, this thing isn't hunting.
Wrong. This is a warm-blooded creature.
This thing doesn't live in the swamp.
This thing's got what, a 25, 27-foot neck? Brachiosaurus neck.
Chopping, then the sound of dragging, then the scent. Some days there's smoke. Now, after 2 months during which I or the children or Kareen has been sick, all we hear is chopping and scraping and dragging. And every day we smell smoke. Today, one of the boys in my afternoon class burst out as he entered, "The road approaches, the road approaches." Dear Felix, the white man is building a road, and it finally reached the cassava fields about 9 months ago. Well, the morning after the road was finished, as far as Alinka was concerned, what should we discover but that the road builders were back at work. They have instructions to continue the road for another 30 miles, and to continue it on its present course right through the village of Alinka. The road builders didn't deviate an inch from the plan the head man was following. Every hut that lay in the proposed road path was leveled. And Sealy, our church, our school, my hut, all went down in a matter of hours. But the worst is yet to be told. Sweet Corrie died from fever and grief, and we buried her in the Olinka way. But Celie, my dear sweet sister, we'll all be coming home soon if we can work something out with the United States Immigration, because they don't know whether we're American or African or missionary. Just pray for us, Celie. And watch for me in the sunset.
What's gotten into you? I'm calling you for an hour. Now get in my shave and don't keep me waiting.
can taste them in my mouth. Oil and cordite.
Jim, come back to the hospital. I need some help with the hospital.
Dr. Rowland, do you remember how we helped to build the runway? If we died like the others, our bones will be in the runway. In a way, it's our runway.
No, it's their runway, Jim.
Try not to think so much.
Try not to think so much.
What my parents looked like. I used to play bridge with my mother in her bedroom. She used to go over there. I'd watch her. You know, dark hair.
Ladies and gentlemen, the young man you just saw in Empire of the Sun, Christian Bale.
When I recall working with Stephen, I can remember a scene where I had to run down some stairs and say something particularly obnoxious. And I was obnoxious throughout the film, but this was obviously exceptional because I got slapped for it. And that we rehearsed this many times so that I wouldn't actually be hit, so the hand would just miss, but it would look for real. And we spent a long time perfecting this, and then eventually we did a take. So Stephen shouts, action. And I ran down the stairs, and I said my line, and smack, she hit me. And she really wasn't holding back. This was no light tap. And I looked up, and Stephen said, excellent, excellent reaction. And I said, well, good, you know, I didn't have to do very much because she hit me. And he said, oh dear, well, let's make sure Christian doesn't get hit again, okay? So, all right. So I go back up and we do another take. And I run down, I say my line, and smack, same thing again. I look up and I relocate my jaw, and they convince me that it really was just another mistake. It's never going to happen again. So I say, all right. Anyway, four or five times this happens, and finally it dawns on me that she's never going to miss. And what's more, Stephen had absolutely no intention of allowing her to miss. And whenever I was out of earshot, he was giving her the thumbs up and saying, same again. Well, despite the momentary pain, it was a real pleasure to work with you, and it's definitely a pleasure to know you.
From always, Mr. John Goodman.
One day when we were filming Always in Western Washington, Stephen and I found ourselves with a little time on our hands. We were walking down the road between setups, and there were huge cranes and trucks, guys screaming at each other, planes making practice runs, and it looked like a battleground, just controlled chaos all around. And Stephen plops down on the film truck and, God, I love making movies. I love making movies with you, sir. Congratulations.
The co-producer who also wrote the music for The Color Purple, Quincy Jones, the Q.
I remember the very first time we met with Stephen. And we both agreed to become teachers for each other. He taught me the camera when he was shooting E.T. I taught him the synthesizer when I was making Michael Jackson's Thriller. Then, in 1985, came The Color Purple. And this was a very, very courageous trip for Stephen because there were no special effects. We're just some African-American people walking around doing a Pulitzer Prize story by Alice Walker. I never will ever forget that experience in my life. Now, Stephen, my brother, I thank you for doing what you did, what you always will do, and for being who you are.
From Jurassic Park, Samuel L. Jackson.
Steven Spielberg is known for fable and fantasy, and for taking us where no director has taken us before. After Jurassic Park, I thought about that, and I started to realize that there was a powerful sense of human dignity that runs through all of Steven's work. He pits human beings against machines, against the killer shark, the T-Rex, supernatural, against forest fires, and against the fires of hate. He pushes human beings to the limits. He challenges the human spirit. And most of all, there is a defiance that says that in the end, the human spirit wins. Thank you, Steven, for putting me in Jurassic Park. Thank you for the challenge, and thank you for helping my human spirit to soar.
Ladies and gentlemen, George Lucas.
I must say that one of the greatest things I have in my life has been a friend of Steven's. And working with him on the indie films was a great experience. He's brilliant in his ability to keep creative focus, especially while dealing with adversity. He's a lot like Indiana Jones that way. Towards the end of the shoot in North Africa, he was supposed to shoot this very elaborate scene of Indy taking out his whip and fighting off a guy with a sword. Harrison, who was very, very ill, said, "Look, Steven, I'm just too sick. I can't keep running to the bathroom like this. You've got to finish this in an hour so I can get back to the hotel." The scene was very, very complicated and involved about 24 setups, and Steven said, "You know, Harrison, the only way I can shoot this scene in an hour is if Indy pulls out his gun and shoots the guy." And the crew standing around him started to laugh, and Steven said, "Hey, this may be a good joke. I think I'll use it." So he shot the scene in less than an hour, got Harrison and the crew back to the hotel, and the joke became an audience favorite. Steven is really a master of imagination. He's a master of spontaneity, and he's really a master of necessity. He understands the craft of making movies better than anyone I know. He is truly the T-Rex of directors. And because of you, my friend, Indy is a part of American film.
Oh my God! God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Is he nuts?
You know that. He's crazy.
Come all around. Prepare to meet Colleen in hell.
Oh, put him away!
Takes the books now.
What book?
You have the diary in your pocket.
You don't. Do you think my son would be that stupid that he would bring my diary all the way back here?
You didn't, did you? You didn't bring it, did you?
Well,
you did.
Look, can we discuss this later?
I should have mailed it to the Marx Brothers.
Will you take it easy?
Take it easy? Why do you think I sent it home in the first place so it wouldn't fall into their hands? I came here to save you. Oh, yeah? And who's going to come to save you, Junior? I told you. Don't call me Junior.
Ladies and gentlemen, from Raiders of the Lost Ark, Karen Allen.
The first time I ever met Stephen was when he came to New York to meet with actors when he was casting Raiders of the Lost Ark. And I walked into the room, we shook hands, and before I could sit down, he looked at me and said, "How well can you spit?" And I don't remember what I said, but I thought it was a very odd question. But when I think about it now, I realize what a really brilliant question it was, because I think it really cut to the heart of who the character of Marion Ravenwood was. You really encouraged me to dive off the high board as an actor, and I really thank you for that. And I feel very lucky to have been part of that wonderful film and part of this extraordinary body of work of yours. Congratulations.
From Jurassic Park, Sam Neill.
I've always thought that Stephen has impeccable taste in actors. So it came as something of a shock when I was asked to be in one of these magical things. I never asked Stephen why he wanted me for this, just in case he changed his mind. I'm glad I didn't, because I've never enjoyed making a film more. And I put this down largely to Stephen's great sense of fun, the sheer fun of making movies. And more than that, and more importantly, his sheer enjoyment of life. Stephen, congratulations and thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, an actor who has left his mark on a generation. An actor known by names such as Stanley Kowalski, Terry Molloy, and Ace Ventura, Pet Detective, Jim Carrey.
The people at the AFI asked me if I would say something nice about Steven Spielberg. And I said, no. Why should I? The guy's never cast me in anything. I went out for E.T. He opted for the puppet. I had all the moves down. And let me tell you something. People knew it was a puppet. It hurt that film. It hurt it. Then there was Jurassic Park. Check this out. Perfect velociraptor, right? Nothing! Now he started this new company, this Fancy Pants Corporation. I don't know what it is, Dreamweaver or something. With these other two guys who, frankly, I've never even heard of. And, I call him up, I ask him if there are any future projects that maybe I might be right for. He says they're still trying to get financing for the company. The guy can't even lie good. And so I think, in closing, I'd like to speak for any other young actor who is yet to experience working with the great Steven Spielberg. Up yours, man!
Ladies and gentlemen, from E.T., Henry Thomas.
I first knew Steven Spielberg when he was 7 years old. I think he still is. I was 10 at the time, and the only difference is that I've grown up a little bit. Just a little. There was always one extra child on the set of E.T., because Steven wasn't just our director, he was our ringleader. Every time I've seen him since, and I've visited him on the sets of Hook and Always, it's the same thing. Whenever there's an element of the supernatural, I think his childlike side takes over. Maybe that's why he's the best director of children ever, conspiring with you to let your emotions out, prodding you along the right path like an older brother. There's hardly a child anywhere on Earth who hasn't been affected by the images and the stories of Steven Spielberg. All of them may not know his name, but they know his films. And he knows their hearts. And more than anyone else in movies, I think he touches the kid in all of us.
Peterson, the Redskins were defeated. Wendy and the boys captured by the pirates. I'll rescue her.
He leaps first at his dagger, and then at his grindstone to sharpen it. Tinka lights near the shell. He rings out a warning cry.
Oh, that is just my medicine. She says, poisoned? Who could have poisoned it?
I promised Wendy to take it, and I will as soon as I have sharpened my dagger. Tinka, who sees its orange color, remembers the red on the pirate's eye. Nobly swallows the draft as Peter's hand is reaching for it. Tink, you have drunk my medicine. She flutters strangely around the room, answering in her very first
way. Ouch!
It was poison.
Ouch!
I drank it to save my life. Tink, dear Tink, are you dying?
Ouch!
Sacred, that you believe.
I do.
If you believe, clap your hands. Many clap, some don't, a few hiss.
And perhaps there is a rush of men.
Thank you.
are, Peter.
Got real big.
Well, welcome back to Neverland, Panda Man.
Stevens, Captain Hook, Dustin Hoffman.
It's really fortuitous that all these people are here tonight to honor you. It allows me the opportunity to express that on March 10th, Outbreak opens. Very wide. I'm not sitting at the Warner's table for nothing, Stephen. And you know that we work together and we love each other, but we know business is business. This is a town of sharks and dinosaurs, and I'm both. I have a very short poem by E.E. Cummings that perhaps he has passed on to you. He isn't looking at anything. He isn't looking for something. He isn't looking. He is seeing. What? Not something outside himself, not anything inside himself, but himself. Himself how? Not as some anyone, not as any someone, only as a no one who is everyone. God bless you, Sir Artist.
From The Color Purple, Danny Glover.
What I remember initially about The Color Purple was that we didn't really have a formalized rehearsal schedule. I mean, you put us in a room and we'd wait for you and an hour or two. And then while we wait, you'd make arrangements for us to do improvisations. We talked about ourselves and our lives and discovering one another. But see, you provided this space whereby we could dream and we could transform ourselves and tell our story. And you took what we gave and wove it into this beautiful tapestry for others to discover their communion with it and with us. Thank you, brother.
Also from The Color Purple, Whoopi Goldberg.
So I'm in New York and I get a call saying Steven Spielberg wants to meet me because he can't come to New York and see my show. Yeah, right. Turns out to be true. I come to California. Steven's assistant said it's three or four people. He just wants to see what you can do. You know, he's heard a lot about your show. Sure, cool. Spielberg, no big deal. So I go, and there's Quincy Jones and Michael Jackson and all these people. I'm from the projects, okay? And I know Steven, because I know Duel, and I know the Night Gallery, and I know Sugarland Express, and I know these movies, because these movies came into neighborhoods and didn't care what you look like, didn't care about your color. It wanted to reach you, so I wanted to reach to this man. So I go and I do my show. I did my show for Steven Spielberg. The whole show. You know, stuff people told me not to do, I did. And Steven came over and said, God, you're really talented. I'm going to be making this movie called The Color Purple, and I'd like you to be the lead. I don't think so. He said, what? I said, no, man, I can't. I cannot take the lead in your movie because I've never been in front of a camera and I don't know anything about this genre and I don't want to mess it up and mess up your career. So I take this man's word for the fact that he said I wouldn't mess up the movie and he'd look out for me. And he did. This silhouette. It's the beginning of my career and the beginning of a different Whoopi Goldberg. So to you, homage on the highest. I am proud, man. Many people will sometimes disparage you for bringing me here, but I... I, through you, have been living my childhood dream. I've got Oscars. I've got hands and paw prints and stuff in cement. Because you believed in me. And you walked me through the door. And nobody can take that away from me. I thank you with everything in my being. Thank you so much for this.
In 1993, Steven Spielberg gave us one of the most significant films ever made. It has been said of Schindler's List that it evokes tears, but honorably. Imagination, talent, and commitment shine in every frame.
Give or take
what, Stern? Give or take what? Count them. How many?
Conversation we had, Stephen, I was very frightened of the film. I was frightened of the collapse of the boundaries between the actor and his role, and how that colossal grief could get into my bones and make me unable to perform for you. And I met you again, and I was wondering how you would encapsulate in one word what you wanted me to do for you. And I was praying that you would use the word witness, and in fact you used the word conscience, which shows how you meet us more than halfway when we are fumbling for our words. To arrive in Poland with you and for me to be the witness and the conscience is a rather abstract thing. So I incorporated my natural rage that was engendered by the material we were working in, a rage that got to such a peak that one morning you asked me how I was, and I wasn't able to say I'm fine, Governor, as we're supposed to say when you ask us how we are in the morning, and I said I'm in a state of rage. And you knew why, because those boundaries had started to slip, and it was getting into my bones, and you said, I'm in a state of rage too. Let's get to work. The guidance that you gave to that group of people in Poland was the guidance of a great patriarch in the historical sense of that word. The list of your films is an absolute good. Our gratitude and our love to you always for being the voice and the conscience of the Holocaust and for most of the 20th century. God bless you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sid Sheinberg.
I have the great honor to present the American Film Institute's Life Achievement Award to Steven Spielberg this evening. The rule book says that this award is presented to an individual who, in a fundamental way, advanced the art of film. Film is said to be the original art form of the 20th century. It has also reached its greatest heights as an American art form. And although Steven's films are among the most commercially successful around the world, Steven is the quintessential American filmmaker. It is most fitting that this director and filmmaker, whose work so often overflows with our country's sense of hope and joy, receive the American Film Institute's Life Achievement Award. Although the mysteries and joys of the future are yet to be revealed, he has already given us many of the greatest moments ever put on film.
Thank you.
present to you the 1995 American Film Institute Life Achievement Award.
First, I have to thank Sid Sheinberg. Sid, I'll be grateful to you for the rest of my life for believing in me and giving me the first opportunity to be a director. Tonight, I want to honor two of the most successful collaborators of my career. So to John Williams and wherever you are, my lifelong editor, Michael Kahn, I wouldn't be standing up here without you. Thank you to all of my collaborators, the people in the business of creating ideas and words. We have no business without the contributions of the writers. And we just are lucky sometimes to pick the right scripts. I want to thank every single actor who came up here for contributing to the piece of the dream, because sometimes what you do in our films becomes the dream itself. Now, I really want to thank my parents. You know, growing up was frustrating for me, because it is, I think, for most kids. But thank you for letting me own that experience. Thanks for giving me the chance to answer some of my own questions, for not panicking and trying to spoon-feed me all the answers, because I think you, as my folks, were secure enough to realize that your kids could never be themselves if you were too busy trying to shape them out of only what you knew. I have been to so many AFI dinners where recipients have only been able to thank their parents by looking up to heaven. And I feel so lucky that all I have to do is look out at table 211 and say how much I love you both. You know, the past recipients of the AFI Award were the original architects of cinema. In fact, you know, the first industry event I ever attended was right here. It was the first annual AFI Award for director John Ford, an artist whose body of work totals more than 130 motion pictures. And just one day before I came to this event, I had just finished shooting my first feature, The Sugar Land Express. And now I stand here before my family and my friends and my industry peers 23 years later with a body of directed work of about 16 movies. I have to get off my ass. The one thing is, I am a cinemaniac. And I'm scared to death of the dark, except when in a motion picture theater. I love to see images, because I love images that tell stories. Before I ever knew how to read, I used to look at the Sunday funnies and still understand everything the storyteller wanted me to. And that's what I love to do more than anything else. I love to make pictures so I can look at them, so you could look at them, and so I can watch you looking at them, which is really, for me, the best part. If I had to single out one area to which I have an utter devotion, it would be with my preoccupation with the idea and the fight to still believe in the idea when so many others around you just don't get it, and the challenge of staying interested in one single idea for sometimes years, and the struggle not to contaminate that idea after months and years of obsessing over it. When I was in my early teens, I stayed up all night writing a screenplay and felt something to this day I swear I cannot get enough of. It was as close to the feeling of flying as I have ever had. You know what I mean when you're trying to get the words on paper and you're three thoughts ahead of yourself and it's a race to get it all down before it goes back to wherever that stuff originally comes from. And it was called inspiration. And I actually made a movie from that script I wrote all night, and it was called Firelight. And it was truly an awful movie. But the process was what it was all about. The experience of that obsessive focus, of having an idea and actually being able to photograph it. That's been the magic potion for me ever since. When I made Close Encounters of the Third Kind with Francois Truffaut, who was in it, he said an interesting thing to me, which I have never forgotten. He said, you can't create a story that you haven't yourself lived in some way. Otherwise, you are just a craftsman. Most of my films have been about an imagination, not a life. But when I made Schindler's List and thought about what Truffaut had said to me, I think for the first time in my career, I felt unrestricted and free to abandon form to tell the story of a life. And with Truffaut's words in mind, I think about my children, Jessica, Theo, Max, Sawyer, and Sasha. My whole life is about you guys. You are my life achievement. For much of my career, my life was only wrapped around the films I directed. Now, thanks to Katie and my five amazing kids, I know who I am without the script. They are the source of my pride, my fulfillment, my inspiration, and my love, and the hope that the best films of life are yet to come. Thank you very much.
He saw a film one Saturday, and that afternoon he found his favorite song. Years later, he asked composer John Williams to use that same theme in Close Encounters of the Third Kind. Here to tie a ribbon around this AFI salute to you, Stephen, are John Williams and the wonderful Bernadette Peters.